Hi, my name is Bruce Goldstein. I'm the Assistant Director for Monitoring and Enforcement of Technology Licenses at the NIH Office of Technology Transfer. I've been working in the field of tech transfer at the NIH for over 20 years, doing the various forms of technology transfer, and I will be talking to you about that topic, intellectual property and technology transfer. The topics I'll be covering in this course, I'll start with what is technology transfer, and then I'll be moving on to the different forms of intellectual property, mainly patents. However, I'll also be covering copyrights, trademarks, and trade secrets. Then I'll move on to technology transfer, the transactional agreements that are primarily aimed at enabling further research, and finally wrap up with how technology transfer, primarily at the NIH, what the impact has been. So what is technology transfer? Well, it's used in different ways at different places, but as a generalized definition, it is the authorized exchange of ideas, information, materials, and often intellectual property rights. It's between laboratories, government, nonprofit, academic, and also with industry. And the purpose of it is to facilitate further research and hopefully the development of commercial products in support of the laboratory's underlying mission, whichever mission that happens to be. Now, it's possible some of you may have heard of the phrase technology transfer used in the drug industry very specifically to refer to the movement of the ability to manufacture a drug from one facility to another. That is a different term, and it is not covered in this talk. So why do we engage in technology transfer? Well, the federal government started funding research in the early 1950s. And in the following 20, 30 years, what we discovered is we couldn't point to a tangible benefit to the public for all this funded research. Sure, there was a lot of science, wonderful publications, but if you actually tried to point to a particular product or some tangible way in which health had improved or other benefit had been and reached, because it wasn't just health funding, we couldn't point to any. Partly that was because some of the federal agencies, in giving out their funding, they said, "We funded it, therefore you need to transfer it to us. We the government, own it." And partly it was because other agencies were saying, no, we're just not going to allow you to do patent because it's in the public interest to make sure it remains unpatented. But as I said, we couldn't point to any benefit from actually having done these two approaches. Did not have a coherent approach to how to turn those federal dollars into something that truly benefited the public. So leading up to 1980 and in 1980, Congress worked on and passed what is now known as the Bayh-Dole Act. They also passed the Stevenson Weidler Act. Bayh-Dole was focused on the recipients of federal funding, and Stevenson Weidler was aimed at the federal labs as well. And the fundamental change was to say, yes, we funded it. However, you, the inventing party, get to keep your inventions and you can license them for commercial gain. And we don't get a cut of any of your royalties that you collect. In 1987, Congress made a second paradigm change in which we were trying to tap federal researchers, the intramural researchers. And that's because although we were interested in collaborating with the private sector, what we were finding is they were turning to us and saying, you, the government, when you invent something, you have to give everyone the opportunity to compete fair and open. Why should we participate in a collaborative project if you're just going to take that invention that comes out of it and hand it over to our competitor? So they would not collaborate with us. So in 1987, Congress passed what is known as the Federal Tech Transfer Act, and the idea was to enable us to participate in that process of technology transfer. Since then, there have been several updates and amendments to make it more up to date, but the paradigm that was set in 1980 hasn't really changed. Technology transfer in the United States, as well as in many other countries, now follows this approach. So for this slide, obviously, I work at the NIH, so it's focused on how we do things at the NIH. However, you'll find that as I go through, it's very adaptable to other organizations as well. So when we engage in technology transfer, that central core of people interact with a wide array of individuals and offices within an organization and outside an organization. So for example, we interact with scientists, management, lawyers, both within the organization and in the outside, the people we're negotiating with. We interact with the patent offices, other tech transfer offices, academia, nonprofits, companies, the FDA and other regulatory organizations, as well as Congress. Within the NIH, we have a central tech transfer office that only handles the central monitoring and enforcement of licenses once they have been executed, and that includes collecting and dispersing royalties. But each of the institutes and centers also has its own technology transfer office to handle the work that is specific to that institute and center. But we also interact with other parts of the NIH. Here are some of the examples, the major examples of what we collaborate within the organization, but it is not the full list. Pretty much, if there is a corner of research at the NIH that might be collaborating, we work with them. Well, thank you for listening. I hope you found it useful and informative. And if you have any questions, please contact the program coordinator.